Hi, is Dr. Sterbo there?
Yes, my name
is Greg. Greg Bonfa.
What's your date of birth?
11-13-70. It's about a list of neurologists and my x-ray and my physical evaluation papers. No, no,
yes?
No, not immigration, just a list of neurologists and other things. He said he would talk to me. Is he busy?
Okay, what's your date of birth? What's your date of birth?
11-13-70. Dr. Silva.
Yes.
How are you?
How are you?
All right. I just want to see if you have the list of neurologists and my physical evaluation.
I'm still working on that, but what you really need is a neurologist who specializes in your problem. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because you're not going to be the best for you.
I wish to be a normal.
This isn't a popular disease.
If you can keep your head clear, you can do anything.
Friend of mine said ALS, it stands for always losing something. And that's a good way to put it, because you're constantly losing something. Except it seems like you don't get it back.
Genetic mutation causes the disease. Just at conception, something happened to this gene that was altered.
He'd take his shirt off and you'd see the twitching underneath his skin all through his chest and shoulders and arms. 6 months after the twitching started, then he started noticing the strength in his left hand, the gripping.
A nurse and a social worker were here, and the nurse goes, do you drink? I said, because of the drugs I'm taking, I don't mix it with alcohol. And she was like, well, you know, that's only if you drive tractors and machinery. If you don't drive tractors and machinery, she said, I would drink if I were you.
It might have been given a bad break, but I've got an awful lot to look for. Thank you.
The first cause of ALS was discovered in 1993.
This gene in ALS, superoxide dismutase, can become mutated. It has now a new property that the normal protein doesn't.
The problem with mutations in SOD1 is not a loss of its normal function, but it's the gain of something new. And every scientist has their theory of what that new thing is.
What we can do is potentially inactivate the mutant product of this gene.
He told me that he was born on November 13th, which is Friday the 13th, and he tells me I was an unlucky baby, that's the reason why I have ALS.
When I was young, I said to God, for any of sins I do, punish me on earth. When I die, I could just shoot right up to heaven. After I got ALS, I prayed a lot to just forget about that plan. who then drew that one?
In ALS, the cells that give rise to the paralysis are the degeneration and death of what we call motor neurons. They extend from the spinal cord, they hook up to the muscles, and when they degenerate, you just can't, the muscle's fine, you just can't move them.
A motor neuron is the only cell that has that incredibly long projection, about a meter in length in humans, that axon. Very unique architecture. So maybe having that abnormal protein in a cell that requires such demands to get messages from its cell body such a long way along, it can't handle after a long period of time to have these abnormalities where other cells have compensations, they don't worry as much with that mutant protein.
What does a motor neuron do? A motor neuron sends an axon. All these axons from individual motor neurons combine to form a nerve. The nerves travel down along the bone, and then they supply the muscles with stimulation. These motor neurons degenerate, the nerves degenerate, and then the muscle degenerates, and people become paralyzed.
This guy, he used to, you know, walk around with a dark cloud on top of him.
That's me.
That's me.
I saw this woman with this disease, and her husband is standing there with, you know, a toddler. The wife had a newborn infant, and the husband looked up at us as a group of scientists, and he looked at us and said, "Now, what are you guys doing? You know, what are you doing? You know, my wife's going to die." And you know, we had no response. It's so tragic. And so that was my emotional jolt that got me into the ALS field. But the disease is very rapid. But we also, it takes time to really understand these processes.
By the time we were in the mall, when you first had ALS, and you were in the wheelchair, and then I didn't really know how to push around that well, and I let go, and she rolled down.
As soon as they come in the room, you can see her face light up like a light bulb. You can actually see it.
During the first 6 months I had
so much. I wanted to say I bought tons and tons of cards for everything I
want to say to them.
Open this when you get fired from your first job. Open this when you are thinking This is the worst day of my life.
Everybody else doesn't really appreciate their mom as much as I do. Like, they'll be like, oh, I hate my mom, she's so annoying. I'd be like, why would you say that? I wish my mom was regular. I wouldn't be saying any of that kind of stuff to her.
So ALS can be divided into two broad categories. Sporadic, which make up the vast majority of cases, and this means that they don't have any known genetic component. And then there's the familial or inherited form.
There are 11 genes known today, probably 14 genes known by the end of the year, whose mutation can be causative of ALS. So we'll find all of the ALS-causing genes in the next handful of years, because the sequencing approaches have become so much better.
I think the field has been explosive within the last 10 to 15 years. A lot of the genetics has become simpler because of the human genome. The whole biology of stem cells is something of the last 10 to 15 years. So all those are tools and reagents for us to work with, and they certainly either were in very early stages or they didn't even exist.
This morning I wrote down two words that I thought were the most important words right now in my life. Falling and waiting. Because anybody with ALS has to wait. Once again, it's your independence gone. You have to depend on others constantly.
Greg and I have known each other almost 40 years, since high school. And I'm spending as much time as I can with Greg, helping him out. Getting him in and out of the van, helping him get dressed, getting some breakfast for him, helping him get around. And it feels good to feel helpful with an old friend. And Greg has a great spirit about him that is good to be around under any circumstances. I think I've learned to be more patient. Just have to slow down, you know, move slowly, don't expect too much. There's only so much you can do in a given day. It's given me much more appreciation for what it means to be disabled or seriously ill.
As we go further down this journey, I'm really going to be dependent on everybody. And if I'm an asshole, they're going to let me know. And it's going to be that's not what I want to be. Because, hell, if I got another year, make it a good one, you know?
In the Navy, I'm a lab captain. I'm retired. And more, I'm a 05.
He would pick up my big dog, Ozzy, and just swing him around, or he'd pick up Joe Hunter or me. I think what changed was he got to spend more time with us, so he needed to rely on us now instead of us relying on him. Why would a good person get such a horrible disease rather than some awful person?
Well, I know that I'm getting angry or depressed. He's like, I know. Me or my family, any good moment, you don't go there.
I got out of my van and walked up, and there was a painting on the ground. So I bent down to pick it up, and when I did, my body fell backwards, and I hit the street. And I was on the ground and I was stuck on the ground. And it was in a parking place and cars are going by. And all of a sudden I realized this is what desolation was like.
What are cancers about? Cancer's about cells that grow uncontrolled, extra growth. And what do we do most of the time? We give patients chemotherapies. What are really chemotherapies? Poisons. We can kill cells really well. ALS is about keeping cells alive. It's a completely different thing, and it's a completely new area for all of medicine.
In ALS, we're talking about a lot of things. We're talking about cell bodies in the brain. We're talking about a very unique projection that comes from that neuron, which is called the axon, which is going and connecting to the spinal cord. From the spinal cord, you have the lower motor neurons that are projecting to the limbs that it has to innervate. It's not one simple system. It's not one organ like the heart that we know this is where it's placed, this is what its function is. It's a complexity.
Left hand. Mm. 12.1. Somebody drinking the game. Oh, don't die.
That's a good picture.
My fat Tyson.
What?
One night I fell through a glass plate window. Yeah. And Paula was asleep. So I woke up, and of course she wakes up out of dead sleep, and she sees blood all over my face. And again, she's like, "What have you done?" You know, I don't know what I've done. You know, I just know I'm hurt. And so what it had done was the glass had gone inside my ear and sliced the inside of my ear.
I kind of freak out and get angry because it scares me. And so after we're sure he's okay and we'll talk about it and everything, and I'll explain why I reacted the way I did. And so, yeah, I mean, we do, I think, communicate well.
So we were thinking of a hoist that if I lay flat, they could get it under my butt and then raise me.
I think she appreciates the help, the shopping and the cooking especially, and knowing that someone's with Greg, I think, is a great relief for her while she's at work Monday through Friday.
I'm Greg. I was the one behind the camera this morning. I'm going to Japan with these. And see you there.
From 1999 to 2001, I taught in Japan. I was a Yokaichi English fellow. I would wake up, have a coffee, cigarettes, take the train, teach, and ate a lot. I was about 100 India pounds. I would buy beer from the vending machines and use underwear. No, I wouldn't buy that, but they do sell it. Karaoke until 4 or 5 in the morning.
Well, I like it better the other way, Greg.
It's a private party.
Did you see something?
But seriously, the English philosopher Socrates?
Oh, yeah,
really?
He's Greek, man. Greek.
The best time of my life. If I could, I would move back to live in that little city. After we got in Japan, we all learned Yokkaichi was one of the most polluted cities is pretty famous for having your country asthma from the air pollution. Even a half or so after I got back, my symptoms of my finger being bent a little started.
At Camp Perry, they're doing a cleanup, which is a chemical cleanup from actually World War II. And it has arsenic and lead, and it might have bothered the deep wells. My neighbor died of ALS, and he had it for 2.5 years. Makes me think the water has something to do with it. In a small neighborhood, two people that live next door to each other come up with ALS.
Environmental factors are likely to play a role, but there's no clear definitive thing that absolutely will cause ALS in the sporadic cases, and it's probably environment on a genetic susceptibility.
So there's something unique with the genetic makeup of individuals who are destined to get ALS. If they are now exposed to certain environmental factors, and we don't understand all of these environmental factors completely, then they will come down with the disease. But if they're kept in isolation and never exposed to these environmental factors, then they may not develop the disease.
You have a predisposition. There may be an injury or an environmental exposure that initiates damage, typically with in one hand or one foot, and then it just sort of spreads along the neuronal axis slowly to ultimately to lead to fatal paralysis, where you just can't move most muscles, especially the muscles of breathing.
I like writing with my hand more than a computer. That is one thing I check daily to make sure I still can do. I used to work here like off and on 15 years. Hell, welcome to the monkey house. I used to get involved with antiques, do gold leaf work, different types of finishes, a lot of European type furniture. It was really fantastic, and to see something restored that everyone else had given up on. Always tell yourself, deal with what you got. Don't wallow in what you've lost. But that's hard to do when all your life you've been doing things, and all of a sudden to lose them.
Well, last year he talked about how he hoped his legs would go first. You know, because you lose the use of your hands and your arms. You're very limited on, you know, you can't do anything.
Well, in Japan, I met a girl, Takuko. I came back, we got married. She had no friends here, no job. She had cultural shock. Things were too stressful. So we got a divorce. Then I got diagnosed with ALS. So it was a wonderful life those years.
I missed our arguments. I missed disagreements. I missed that part that, you know, made us two adults talking to each other.
And for me, I can't. and their wife, but there's nothing I can do about it. You know, worry about them growing up without my next support. That even now I've provide, you know, in the Navy and the VA.
We've been together, 14 years, and now it seems like we're getting into some more depth and strength and love.
I think it brought us all closer together because we're kind of like both working together to try and figure this thing out, you know, trying to figure out what to do with this thing.
There's two things that happen when people help you. One, you don't want their help even though you need their help. Or two, you're glad to have their help and you try to show them. And I'm caught somewhere in between right now.
I think at first Greg probably was feeling bad about me having to take care of him, the burden it would put on me, the stress. So I've always just tried to let him know that I'm here for him, you know, and I'll do what I can, as long as I can.
The people around me all understand that my decisions are my decisions. They're there for whatever, good, bad, or ugly. And I really admire them being there for me because that's really all you can ask in life. And I'm a lucky man because I'm surrounded by it.
And today we're going to a ball game.
Thank you.
Y'all have a nice time.
Okay, you too.
Hey, Mort.
You ready? How's it going?
No.
Cool. Very cool. Absolutely. We'll put it together. I'm still in shock. I mean, he's my younger brother, and it's not supposed to happen that way.
God bless you, darling. You're in our prayers, yeah. And we're thinking about you. Okay?
I clasped his heart and said, "That's my prayer." Cool. He's impressed.
Walk me a little bit through when you first found out that you have ALS.
It came on.
Why not that person?
I was in more denial, I think, than my mom. I tried looking everywhere for like alternative things to do and like people who have been like around for 20 years with ALS, and some of it we tried and it didn't work, and it was just, I really couldn't accept the fact that my mom was gonna die. I didn't really want to think about that.
But there's booze in the blender. And soon it'll render.
And soon it'll render.
That froze a concoction that helps me hang on.
That froze a concoction that helps me hang on.
This is where you first look for ALS. And see the indentation? That's because the muscles are gone. And Dr. Bell, she grabbed me in those two places and squeezed really hard. And I said, what are you doing? You know, why are you grabbing my hands like that? She says, Greg, that should have brought you to your knees. Like yesterday, trying to eat was very difficult. And that's the first time I've had that difficulty where my arm didn't want to pick up my hand. It's sad.
There's a simple thing. Put my hand on the mouse. See how much I swivel.
For many years, the entire field assumed that all the disease was from damage that was inside those motor neurons. But the truth is, if you look at the genetics of disease with 11 known causes, all of the genes whose mutation causes disease are expressed broadly everywhere in the body. How does it just lead to the damage of motor neurons?
We now know pretty convincingly that those motor neurons die because the cells around them push them into dying.
It's the support cells around that motor neuron that are also abnormal. And so instead of trying to replace a motor neuron which has such exquisite interactions and connections, that might be a huge hurdle. But if we can improve the surroundings of the neuron, we know that we could maybe make a huge effect on how the motor neuron is.
It's not, I believe, bad luck. It came first. And then I realized I'm just screwed.
It's hard to cheer him up when he's in those cases, because you never know. You have to, you know, we have to be in his shoes to know what it really feels like.
Usually say it's Nanya. Mm-hmm.
Nanya? Nanya business.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very
sorry
for
that conversation.
About what?
On the moon weird bag. Usually we talk about some prostitution
and then Greg starts asking me about personal questions.
Can you ask one right now, Hoover? What do you want to know, you asshole?
You get that, okay?
What I see is a beautiful young lady whose mind is still perfect and whose body is failing her. And there's nothing that I can do about it except chant. Nam Myoho Renge Kyo, which is my Buddhist chant. If it wasn't for that, I don't know where I'd be.
I look at him as a stronger person than I ever thought he was. I didn't think he was going to be doing this much, and he's like here 4 times a week, helping out constantly, like getting up in the middle of the night. And it's not usually what people his age or in his position do. I was really surprised, and I was really like, now I know I can rely on him for a lot of things.
I'm spending more time with my daughter than I ever did before. And we're having fun. We laugh together, we cry together, we argue together. And that's a beautiful thing.
This is like where he wants to be more than anything. I can see it.
I make her laugh. That makes me happy.
I've been to a neurologist, but doctors, in terms of treatment, they're useless. You go there to diagnose your problem, and then you do your own research.
I was getting a negativity towards doctors, traditional doctors, because it seemed like there was no compassion. You know, like, okay, what are we supposed to do? Throw the ALS people over in the corner? You know, just keep piling them over there? You have the right to fire anyone. You can just say, you're done. You know, you're not helping me, you know. And that's what ALS people need, is help, you know, to figure out what the hell's going on.
I think it'd be a lot worse if you didn't have your family
support.
Right.
The majority of the patients that come to the ALS clinic come one, maybe two times, and then they never come back. And it's because they sort of give up. I go there because I want to hear what's going on. That a doctor's going to say, oh yeah, Greg, go over in this building, they're going to shoot you up with stem cells. Your body's going to change in an hour, and you'll be good as new, you know? In the back of your mind, you think you're gonna learn that. You know, around any corner, there could be a cure.
140 years of ALS's recognition as a disease, we have absolutely, totally nothing.
And Ryutech is the one drug that's approved by the FDA, and it supposedly extends your life by 90 days.
We've studied at least 24 drugs since Ryutech, and none have been successful. It takes 10 to 15 years to go from a brand new chemical to the completion of all the clinical trials necessary to go to the FDA for final approval. That's a long time. It takes about $1.3 billion to complete it for almost any drug, regardless of whether it's an ALS relevant drug. And for every 13 drugs that make it through that process and go to the FDA, only one will be successful.
Some who had had a very early, almost preliminary experience with IPLEX, they all found the same thing, that it caused enormous relief of the symptoms of the disease. Somehow nature causes the medication to go right to the affected muscle groups. And if we're able to control the symptoms, if we're able to at least stop them from progressing further, that in itself is a heck of an accomplishment.
You know, this disease is such a mystery. Nobody knows what causes it. They don't know, they don't understand it. That's why we're trying to urge, you know, the release of IPLEX, because if we can get IPLEX release, we can do, we'll have our own trial. And we're not gonna go away. And just because of this ugly disease, it may affect our voice, it may affect our muscles, but it can't dampen my spirit, it can't dampen these people's spirit.
There's this line that's in my head right now that goes,
action moved by hope.
You toss and you turn and you tear up the sheets. You're wondering why you can't sleep.
I think pharmaceutical companies, they're companies, they're looking to make money, you know. There's not necessarily a...
I mean, it's probably overshadowed, if I may, darling, by the, you know, more important concerns like hair growth and...
Yes, and erections.
About to explode because you carry the load by yourself.
Maybe companies don't get involved in ALS cancer because they can't make enough money. That might be the case, although there's a very well-known company in the United States, Genzyme, that treats a handful of patients, and yet it's a $1 billion-a-year company. So ALS is not a common disease, but it doesn't mean drug companies can't find a way to develop an appropriate business or economic model around it.
What attracts the pharmaceutical industry now is a success story. So even if they got a very promising drug in a smaller market, which ALS is, I think it would both boost the company's profile, and also these drugs might be of value in Parkinson's, Huntington's, and other diseases, increasing their market size.
No two people are taking the same thing. It leaves it up to each individual to be their own advocate. Even when it doesn't work, you still just try something else.
I'm on a ton of different supplements, a lot of B vitamins, creatine, which helps keep my muscle mass, CoQ10.
Which way is better?
I still take vitamin B12. And my neighbor got me on CQ10.
Brian,
I don't want
anything to keep me here longer
than I need to be.
Like this.
In my hair, there's a lot of gray. It wasn't there yesterday.
We spend a long time among scientific groups thinking of how do we prioritize, what is the study that is so compelling that we need to bring forward. And sometimes it's because the patient population have been involved in taking a particular drug that needs to be verified, whether it is. There have been different reasons for doing different trials, but there's a whole host of compounds that are constantly being considered.
I'm all for certain alternative medicine. You know, some of it I have a hard time believing myself. You know, some of it seems kind of like witch doctor medicine, you know. But things like acupuncture that's, you know, been practiced by the Chinese for centuries, there's got to be something to that. People have seen results from it.
According to a modern medicine theory, the needles stimulate the nervous system, and it seems like through the brain. They've done studies with MRI scans where they've done different points, and the areas that the things that points are supposed to treat, those areas of the brain become more active on an MRI scan.
So I sort of go with my intuition when it comes to that, what I feel good about, what my body wants. Read this, if this makes sense. If it works, then we go on with it. That's about how I do that. Because I know there's no miracle, or not miracle, any cure. And I know there's a lot of things out there. Everyone's trying to find the big secret. And,
In the last couple of weeks, every position is uncomfortable. And then one side, uncomfortable. Back. And uncomfortable something. And I want to say I'm breathing like a shortness of breath, like. But when I was on that table, I felt relaxed and able to lay there for more than 5 minutes without trouble.
We use this for people with ALS that have got some muscle loss that we can't manually go in and adjust. Doesn't feel like much. It just feels a little bit of pressure. But with that spring-loaded tension, we actually can get movement in the vertebra.
Felt like a snapping a huge rubber band on you, but it didn't hurt.
Any type of sclerosis or nerve problem, I feel that there's a blockage in his mind of how he's thinking.
You have a very strong mind. So you have the ability in your mind to do a lot of healing.
Suicide, constant depression.
One of our goals is to remove you out of that constant depression. We understand, anyone that's sick, you cannot not get depressed once in a while. But the more positive we remain, the stronger your path is to become healthier. Visualize this beam of light just in a circle, a ball of energy just between your hands. This is what we call energy balls. And then what you do is you embed it back into your body for healing.
Way thing you can do to help me get a girlfriend?
Love magnet.
Yes, but first we have to do the the healing, and then we're gonna do that.
You can say I felt less heavy afterwards, more light, more relaxed, maybe.
The depression that he was talking about, I felt. There was a lot of hurt. He feels trapped right now in his body. It's okay that you're in this physical body. There's a reason, there's a journey, there's a purpose why we're here right now. Use your communication. You can probably help lots of people.
Spend all my time trying to do all kinds of alternative things, or I could put the energy into life. I can't do both half, only 100%.
We have no way of knowing who's going to get ALS, so we can't look at them before they develop disease. And we only have a short period of time to look at them while they're alive. And finally, there's not a lot we can look at. We can't take out pieces of their brain and spinal cord to understand what's wrong, because we would horribly damage them. And it's unethical to do that. It's never done in modern medicine.
Unfortunately, we don't have great ways of telling these diseases in early stages. And at the time you start having symptoms, too many of those neurons have already died. Would it be possible to use cells to either replace the cells that are gone, dead, or have the cells support the cells that are dying?
One possibility now is the fact that through discoveries made recently, we can reprogram adult stem cells to become more embryonic, and we can then make them develop these motor neurons from these skin cells from patients.
Up until now, the stem cells differentiated into neurons, not motor neurons. In other words, it's not that the stem cells made axons and sent these axons all the way to muscle and got all the signals up above from the brain. But they helped the motor neurons to survive more.
Can we in humans imagine that we can exquisitely reconnect that neuron to all the right places? It's still a very tricky hurdle.
Maybe the shorter ones. So maybe the ones that, for example, go from the spinal cord to the muscles that control speaking, which patients really, these are very important ones. Maybe the shorter ones that we have real hopes using stem cells.
I've had lately a lot of dreams, every night, two or three. The guy came in through the door. His face was in shadow, so couldn't see any features. He said to me, "Did you write your grandmother yet?" I thought he must have known me if he had said. He had a leather jacket like Fonzie. And he came closer to me, and his face came into view. And then I realized I didn't recognize him at all. And he put his arms out to me to grab, like my shoulders or neck. So I held his arms like this, and he brought his face really close. I was so scared. I was shaking. It was nightmarish. And then I woke up. So, what's that mean?
One time I couldn't work. Yeah, so I knew it. The artwork was
the joy of being able to be his creative outlet and produce something on the canvas that came from our, both our creative sides.
She never took my direction and put it down on camera. Very nice.
And it's really nice to see the fruit of our labors at the end, how our ideas mesh together to make something so beautiful.
I was cheated in my whole life. Now I have no job, no career, no wife, can't work, can't really talk. I'm in the hell now. So of course I believe in it.
It bothers me if he's bitter or if he's angry or if, you know, it bothers me because that could be me. It could be me in a year. I mean, it, you know. And I want to help him somehow. I don't know how I can do that. I don't know if anybody can do that except himself. It's not the end. It's not the end. But he wants people to understand where he's coming from, too. Yeah. And he doesn't believe healthy people can. Yeah.
We took the first known cause of ALS, a mutation in a gene called superoxide dismutase, and we showed that we could silence it by infusing a DNA drug.
A silencing molecule will seek out the messenger RNA for this mutated gene. And it will seek it out, it will bind to it, and it will destroy it.
So by infusing these DNA drugs that can pair with a specific RNA, it makes that RNA a target for this enzyme that's already sitting in our cells. And so that enzyme just degrades the RNA. So now you can't make the product of that RNA, which would be a protein, and if the RNA carried a mutation in it, so that the protein would have a mutation in it, now you've silenced the mutant protein. Now the real test will be, is it going to be tolerated sufficiently? Is it going to reach all the right cells, enough of the right cells, to have real efficacy?
I put myself in my work, and so everyone would get a piece of me. But my customers have said, take your time. And it's like, you better watch what you're saying, because I'll do it. You can laugh at me, it's okay.
Together,
yes.
One night.
Together, yes. One night. In Greg's backyard, yeah. For ALS, yeah.
Yeah. Luckily, we have good friends and a lot of support from family and friends, and I think without them, I'm not sure where we'd be.
Joke about Lou Gehrig. Isn't it funny that Lou Gehrig got the same disease as his name?
When I met my first ALS patient, which was Ashley's dad, I was so blown away. And I just couldn't get him out of my mind. You know, at night I would lie there and think of this poor guy sitting in his house, eventually, and other patients unable to move, just staring at the walls, not able to talk. I can't even go a minute without scratching an itch. And, you know, these poor people can't move a muscle. They have to blink to communicate, yes or no. I just couldn't stand it. I just couldn't stand thinking about it. So I had to help. It wasn't even, I guess in a way I was doing it for myself. I needed to do something.
We got involved because my wife's best friend, Linda Sargent, passed away from ALS in 06. We opened up the local paper, and there was a Camacho family in there. So my wife said, well, must be a sign from God to do something. We have a Harley-Davidson dealership. And she thought, well, how about having a ride for this family? And it's just kind of started in the living room about a month and a half ago. And we got people to donate, local businesses to donate money for prizes for the raffle. And that's kind of how it worked out. The Harley-Davidson community is a great community for raising money for charities. So
it's very important that people understand that people need to give back. And I have no problem doing that, and I'd love to do it.
I think that this community is doing more than I could ever think. If I would let them,
they would do a lot more.
Why is this a citizen? I want to come in here and say no, it's all right. She said, it looks like it's coming. I don't need an answer. Father, come and come away here.
I just miss the privacy of everything.
I wish you would have gotten another disease like cancer or something else that we could have had maybe a fighting chance. With this here, I mean, it's tough. At nighttime when I go to bed, you know, waiting for a call, I lay in bed thinking like, man, I've known this lady for a long time. You know, we were both 16. We started dating.
16?
Yeah, we started dating, and we've gone through a lot.
How old were you when you got married?
20.
Usually in situations where you would have a mom help you, who's going to be there to support me? Like when I get married or I have kids or I go away to college, what it's going to be like when I have my mom there and everybody else has their moms.
Like force them to be here and help. I don't want my girls to one day look back and say, I wish I would have spent more time with her while she was alive. Sometimes I miss out on things and I get sad because I want to go to stuff, but I like helping her because then we can spend more time together.
You know, a lot of these people, you know, they can't clean themselves every day like they'd like to. You know, they can't thank others because of the way they talk or can't talk, and they're with a feeding tube and there are machines, and they don't attract the sympathy that they should have. And this disease, it's a beast. And people just overlook them.
What are the options now for treating sporadic ALS? Cases where you know there's a bad gene or a gene whose synthesis you would like to lower, the DNA drug approach is a great approach. For cases where you might want to add good cells, the good cells being, say, glial cells that would replace the damaged glial cells that were already present, then the stem cell approach is absolutely the designer approach of choice.
The two people I was traveling with wanted to go down to the Cologne River and go swimming. So they left me there with all these people who all spoke Spanish and I did not. So I took out my flute, it's a bamboo flute called a shakuhachi. And I just closed my eyes and started playing the flute. And after playing for a few minutes, I realized there was someone close to me. And when I opened my eyes, there was this guy staring at me, smiling. So I just kept playing the flute, and all the people kept smiling, and I felt right at home, right at home.
Thank you.
About other people that are further along with this disease, and I admire people for going as far as they do, but I know for me it may be different because quality of life is different for everybody.
She's told me many times, I'm not afraid to die, Dad. She said, I just don't want to leave my children.
While
people are fighting for a cure. There are people who are
living
as and suffering with this disease.
You don't have to be so scared.
It's not going to get any better. It's just going to get worse.
It's just terrible to see somebody go through this. And there's nothing you can do.
This is what we've been chosen to bear, and that we have to live on and try to just keep fighting, not give up. There has been good things, oddly, that came out of the disease, like our pain and collaboration and closeness of our family.
I'll visit you. You know, ALS, if we could find a therapy for it, would be as common as MS, but MS patients survive longer, so you have more people with the disease. And so I think that to say that it's that rare a disease, it probably isn't. It's just that people, in average, there's exceptions to it, live between 2 to 5 years. One of the hurdles for our future is funding. We need so much of it for drug development and for clinical trials. So if there's an obstacle, that's one of it. It's dollars, it's funding. It costs millions of dollars to develop new therapies.
If we don't invest as a country, as a community, if we don't invest, we'll be giving patients the same answers next year and the year after and the year after. And it's not just ALS, it's the broad spectrum of human neurodegenerative diseases. Again, in none of them do we have effective therapies that slow the rate of disease advance.
All the things we can do, I think if we spend more money trying to cure diseases than we did like blowing things up, I think we'd have a lot better world. And this we shouldn't be that way. I'm not sure what the reasons are that, you know, that it, obviously it hasn't been cured, it's barely understood.
And the courage that so many of these people find to persevere with this thing without complaining. It's amazing. And, you know, I think all the able-bodied people out there that are, you know, their problems and my problems are so trivial compared to these people.
Never give up hope.
We are much closer for specific inherited forms of ALS of really understanding what is going wrong, at least the initial steps, and the cells who are accumulating the damage that drives the process. For sporadic ALS, we've made progress. We know that there are commonalities of deficits. There's reason for high optimism that mechanism-based drugs will be identified in the next handful of years.
A great focus is on finding drugs that would actually stop the disease or significantly slow it down. And I do think that's possible.
Fasim Cliff is rather well known to different races of the forest Shia as a landmark where that tiny, obscure Phasmarian village is located. The name of the cliff is obviously of Phasmarian origin. Phasmers are not spoken of much, for no widely known battles or events have been attached to the Phasmers, and what little is spoken of them has to do with their infamous penchant for thievery.
Must have been about 10 years old, Greg happened to come upon an old broken video recorder, and for some reason we both believed that we could fix it. And under that premise, we began working on a screenplay for what would be the movie Bontella. Of course, I objected to the name, but it stuck, you know, it stuck anyway.
It's basically a fantasy novel of two boys rescuing a village and winning over a love, just like anybody would want to do in real life.
And in each of these characters, I see people in my life and in Greg's life, because we always write about what we know. Well, when you read the book, you read about friendship.
The story of two lifelong friends named Casimir and Theorist. It's the story of Greg and I. In our hearts, we will always be an adventure together, slaying monsters, winning the love of a beautiful maiden, but most of all, fighting back to back for the love of one another.
The story of Bontella blossomed into a great story, not because of anything that I did in particular, but because of the mind of Greg Bonfa. This incredible talent for lyrical prose, flowery prose, almost aromatic prose. You can put yourself in the forests and smell the mold and the moss, and it's a beautiful story, and so I want to focus on those areas that Greg wrote. A narrow orange glow from the faraway falling sun sliced through the sky, cutting a deep scar into the atmosphere. The air became suffused with a cold wind, and the orange glow from the sun spread out into a haze of warm colors. He had walked from his village only a few minutes away to the cliff's edge where he now stood. The little phasma had moved past the thin green trees that surrounded his wide feet. During his walk, the air seemed warmer to him than now, for the trees had sheltered him from the cold. But here, at the silent cliff's edge, there were no trees.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Greg. Happy birthday to you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Chris.
You're welcome. Thank you, Greg.
So we've come here today to check out where Dad is, his spirit, or whatever. I've never seen the headstone on it, either as my nephew. I resented it when I was a kid that people say, "Oh, you look like your father." I was like, "Well, okay, if I have to." But then I learned all that really didn't matter. That if you have gifts that your father has given you characteristically, it depends on what you do with them. Under the oak trees, we had the peace accords, but we called it the peace acorns under the oak tree. And we shook hands to say that he no longer was my father and I no longer was his son. We were just friends. They were doing the best they could with what they had.